You're the truth, and you do it all so natural. You're so strong, and you show it anything. If you want it, it's yours. It's yours. You can have it all, yeah. Up early this morning, and I know God smiled on me. Ain't no time to sleep, no, no. I can't wait to start my day because I know it's gonna be beautiful like me. Hey, you, you're so beautiful. You're the truth, and you do it all so natural. You're so strong, and you show it anything. If you want it, it's yours. It's yours.
You can have it all, yeah.
Hey, you, you're so beautiful. You're the truth, and you do it all so natural. You're so strong, and you show it anything. If you want it, it's yours. It's yours.
You can have it all, yeah.
I look into my mirror, I love everything I see. Ain't no mistakes on me, no. I always remind myself there ain't no other me. Can't nobody else be. Hey, you, you're so beautiful.
And hello, welcome to this week's edition of Style and Empowerment Chat with Laura and Friends Radio on Take It to the Streets, Downtown Hot, and London Energy Radio. So we are just so excited today. Well, first of all, I have to say I get my day started off right when one of my besties calls me and just tells me how empowered and fabulous they're feeling, and it peeps me in on some exciting things we're going to be doing together in the next couple of months. Can't say yet, but it's just exciting when your friends are winning and you're able to be part of those exciting things that they have happening. So it's awesome. Of course, we had a pretty busy weekend. We were at the Damien Escobar concert this Sunday at the beautiful Keswick Theater. And I just accidentally stumbled upon the most amazing chic old Hollywood glam restaurant, which gave me so much, the decor gave me so much life. I literally felt like I was walking into a 1950s movie, and Rita Hayworth and Marilyn Monroe were just going to be around the corner. So I immediately walked into this place and had a million ideas of things that I wanted to do in the future. So Dino's Backstage Celebrity, it's Dino's Backstage Restaurant, and it's in Glenside, right next to the Keswick Theater. And if you're looking for a place that gives you old Hollywood glam and character, and just the whole atmosphere is super chic and just makes you feel fabulous as soon as you walk in, definitely visit that restaurant. They have the whole walls throughout the whole restaurant are black and white photographs of all old Hollywood movie stars. And the doors that separate the dining rooms have little stars on it, like, you know, movie set dressing rooms. It's just so super fab. I mean, you can't walk into a hip atmosphere like that and be in a bad space. I always say decor is everything. Decor creates the mood, creates the energy. So I was just hanging out and luxuriating while I was awaiting for Damien Escobar. Now, first of all, for those of you who aren't familiar with Damien Escobar, go to your YouTube and get familiar, because he is an amazing classical violinist that infuses hip-hop, pop music. He does original compositions, but he also takes like songs like Rihanna, Alicia Keys, Michael Jackson, and does like a soulful pop violin a remake of it. And of course, much of the music of Motown and disco, you know, has like Earth, Wind, and Fire, Thelma Houston. These songs are lush with string instruments mixed with R&B. So really, a lot of disco is a fusion of R&B and classical music. So for his VIPs, Damien treated us to a private concert. So we, it was just us in the theater, literally, you know, he's right there, no backup musicians, just him and his violin. I literally felt like I'm just sitting in the living room and Damien's giving me a private concert. It's so fantastic. The other thing, I mean, of course, Damien, if you've never been to one of his concerts, they're always just amazing energy. You know, he really interacts with his crowd, and he is really about spreading, you know, love and energy and light, and using his own story as a testimony to empower his fans and followers. You know, for those of you who aren't fully familiar with his career, he rose to fame in the early mid-2000s with his brother. They, you know, had this violin group. It was them, you know, a group. I forget the name of it. But they, you know, shot to fame, had some albums, made it on, you know, the talk shows and everything. And then there's some situation where they broke up. And then different things happened, and Damien actually walked away from the music business, and he was homeless for a bit of time. And then one day, you know, he relates the story that he was on the street with his daughter, and his daughter said, "Daddy, you know, what's next?" And that was the day he basically got out of his funk, his issues, his things, and picked up the violin again, and now has risen back up to fame. He openly talks about his battles with depression, and how music is really an outlet. And of course, Damien is only just an amazing artist. You know, he has written 2 children's books. He's very active in musical empowerment and funding of the arts and scholarships, and really does a lot of great things for the community. And at his concert, he always talks about love and the power of love, and just how music is an escape, and just, you know, kind of leave your problems to the side and just become enraptured by the music. And of course, Damien has a very empowering, you know, personal story. But what I wasn't prepared for, which was just so inspiring to me, is during the middle of the concert, he told the crowd, in which he really didn't have to reveal this, but, you know, it's really a credit to him that he just wants to uplift and empower people and use his platform to do such. And he revealed to the crowd that he was recently diagnosed with Lyme disease. And, you know, he had been feeling fatigued and sick and run down and viral. You just kind of let it go, because oftentimes we do. We feel symptoms and we say, oh, it's not real. I will get over it. But he was just feeling sick for longer than normal. And he, you know, was thinking, well, what's going on? Let me get to the doctor. So long story short, they ran a battery of tests, and the doctor revealed that he had Lyme disease. So, of course, you know, those of you who aren't familiar with Lyme disease, it's an autoimmune a condition, and I, you know, attacks the healthy antibodies in your body that helps you, you know, fight diseases. And it can also attack your muscles. So, you know, oftentimes you're weak, you go through long periods of fatigue, and it makes it really hard to balance your everyday life. And especially when your profession requires you to really be in peak physical condition because you're on the road all the time, you're traveling, that takes a certain level of mentality and physicality and endurance. So they told him about a month ago or so that he had Lyme, literally just a month ago, that he has Lyme disease. So he said, you know, when he got the diagnosis, he was devastated. He went home and he started Googling all this stuff about Lyme disease, and the doctor really wasn't giving him a lot of positive, like, this is how we live with it. This is, you know, and he was literally ready to retire and to stop performing and to cancel the tour. I'm basically thinking, like, look, my professional life's over as I know it. This is going to happen. That's going to happen. And he continued to share with the crowd that then he came to a moment where he's like, okay, well, you know, let me start researching, how do I survive? How do I live with lupus, and, you know, how do I make healthier choices to deal with it and still function in life? And then at that point, then that's where he called his team up and said, look, we're going back out on the road. And he said, you know, what the pivotal moment for him was deciding that he wasn't going to become his diagnosis. So just because the doctor gave him this upsetting news, he wasn't going to, you know, get into that dark projecting thinking where, you know, it's like they say self-fulfilling prophecy. Like someone will say to you, oh, well, you're never going to walk again. And you don't, because the doctor tells you, and you get into that, oh, well, I can never be that again. I can never this, right? Your mind is just as powerful as your body and what's going on inside your body. And whatever condition or situation that you're dealing with, your mental, it is the first key to, you know, reclaiming whatever percentage of your pre-diagnosis life. And so, you know, we of course can expand that to life. You know, we get bad news, or we lose an opportunity, or we get knocked down on the ground in some way. You know, let's not run away with ourselves when someone gives us some negative, you know, because there's always a way where you can, you know, push yourself past certain circumstances to some degree. Sometimes without meaning to, you can actually make the situation worse and actually manifest the negative. Like we talk about manifesting, you know, goals and putting that energy out there and manifesting, you know, positive things. Well, you can also manifest negative things by, like, getting in that mentality that negative possible eventuality already happened, and that you're basically mentally packing it in and not trying anymore. So I just thought it was just so empowering And just great that he really shared that with the crowd. And it's just such positive messages. Of course, I have a good bit of the footage from the concert on the Style and Empowerment Chat with Laura and Friends Facebook page. So you can check that out, like it, and share. And, of course, this weekend, Sunday, Take It to the Streets was out on set. I was... former guest of Style and Empowerment Chat with Laura and Friends, author, hip-hop fiction, urban fiction author Omar Tyree, was back in town filming a short film and in this new music video called Fly Girl. And Lady C and our former guest, Nakia Dillard, who, of course, heads his acting school and casting company Akin Acts, helped to cast the film. And Take It to the Streets own Lucinda Trotter was also in the film and helping to cast it as well. So we're excited. You know, Omar Tyree does a lot of great things for the youth. So, of course, Tuesday, yesterday was primary day. So one of the exciting wins in Philadelphia, under the umbrella of girl power, Rochelle Bilal was just elected the first female sheriff ever in Philadelphia. So I'm super excited about that. Of course, last night we were at the Academy. Oh my gosh, I'm so tired. I'm totally blacking out. So the Academy of Peace in Wilmington, Delaware. So we were out there last night, and I was invited to be one of the featured speakers of the Wear Your Crown series, which is produced by Miss Annette Fletcher, who's a former Miss Delaware BBW and is also involved in producing the Miss Delaware BBW pageant. So, you know, I was speaking a lot about finding your power and self-love and overcoming negativity and not projecting and, you know, all these good things. So you can peep that also on the Style and Empowerment Chat with Laura and Friends page. So now... little scandalicious story in some chickens have come home to roost. This isn't celebrity gossip, but this is pretty juicy from a consumer point of view. So, in what might be the biggest price fixing scheme in U.S. history, Connecticut and a coalition of more than 40 states in the U.S. just filed a 500-page lawsuit accusing some of the biggest generic drug makers in the United States, including Teva Pharmaceuticals, which is a branch here in the Philly area, of scamming consumers out of billions of dollars through hiking the price of generic drugs more than 400%. So, of course, I'm sure we've all noticed as we go to get our antibiotics and different prescriptions, they keep getting more and more expensive. And, of course, you know, U.S. law states that this is just popping. Urban Outfitters is running out clothing subscription services for $88 a month. So a lot of the retailers like Ann Taylor and Urban Outfitters are having, basically it's kind of like Rent the Runway. But anyhow, so under U.S. law, generic drugs are supposed to, you know, basically be the economic version of the name brand drugs. So, and oftentimes with insurance companies, you know, they'll give more coverage if you get your prescription in generic. And the generic is supposed to cost, under law, substantially less than the name brand. So basically, it's become revealed under, after a 5-year investigation into the U.S. pharmaceutical drug business, that all these generic companies basically circled their wagons together to fix prices at high rates that really isn't much different than the name brand, so they could all profit. And they were basically doing kickbacks to insurance companies, doctors, and the drug companies were taking exorbitant amounts of profit. And of course, then the result is many of us can't afford the drugs that we need to survive or to maintain, you know, a good physical health. You know, like your inhaler, you know, 4 or 5 years ago cost you a copay of $15. Now it's a copay of $75, right? You know, did the ingredients change? No. So, and of course, then the ripple effect of that is many people aren't seeking medical treatment. Might be moderate conditions, which then escalate to chronic because they can't afford the copays. So, you know, apparently, the U.S. Supreme Court ordered, you know, a panel investigation, and now all, like, the tree is shaking. So, you know, we anticipate probably over the next couple of months that many of these drug companies are going to go out of business, or they're going to really have to restructure everything that they do. And, of course, now that the Supreme Court is watching them, they can't get away with all that kickbacks. Because you think about it, when you're sitting in your doctor's office and these drug salesmen come to the doctor's office and they're giving out their free samples and all that stuff, you know, in the contract, the doctor gets a cut of every prescription he provides. Because really, he's selling the drugs. You know, in a kind of cleaned up way. You know, you say, oh yeah, you need this and you need that and you got to be on this and that and then take this for that side effect and this for that and that and for this and this. And you're like, before you know it, you're like, gee, I just had a headache. Why am I on 4 different pills? Right? And half the time, these medicines they put you on, you know, have these side effects, and you have to take another medicine for the side effect, and some of the side effects of these drugs that they list are worse than the condition that you're taking the drug for. So, you know, it's really going to be pretty interesting to see how this shakes out. But we're going to take a musical break. And when we come back, we're going to talk about some of our R&B diva icons who are getting Ivy League recognition. So keep it locked in to Style and Empowerment Chat with Lauren Friends Radio. And we'll be back after this.
What do you want?
Britney Spears and the unstoppable danger. You're gonna have to remove me, cause I ain't going nowhere.
We got a caller on line one. Caller, what's your problem?
Hello. I'm on the radio with T-Bain.
How's it going?
Ain't going good. My girl ain't doing a thing she used to do at all.
I got just what you need. Brand new Chris Brown, T-Pain. You heard it here first. Nappy Boy Radio. We love you.
She want that loving, dubbing, dubbing, dubbing. Kiss.
country boy from Tappahannock. VA is where I reside, so shawty, understand it. And I know I just turned 18 and I get a little mannish. And you see this bandana hanging, that means I'm like a bandit. Like a bandit, bandit. I got paper, girl, the Lamborghini with the spider seats. You never seen it, so get it, shawty. We parking lot pimping in my dome. And I know what you want.
And welcome back to this week's edition of Style and Empowerment Chat with Lauren Friends Radio. So giving you a little sea breezy throwback. So, of course, we're eagerly awaiting the full album that Chris Brown is cooking up. He's been kind of giving us breadcrumbs the past couple of weeks. You know, he just released that song with Usher. And then Usher, him and Jacquees, that kind of made me scratch my head. I'm like, what? But I'm like, okay. But we know when it drops, it's going to be good. So, speaking of music, of course, we were just playing Britney Spears before the break. Her longtime manager just came out and announced this week that basically Britney Spears is going on a non-determined length of time of career hiatus. Of course, she checked herself into a mental health facility in March. And then a little bit after that, then everybody was trying to, you know, make, oh, she's in there against her will and free Britney and all this stuff. And, of course, Britney, you know, her father, who she's very close with and who is her conservator, Which means when someone has a conservator, the conservator is the person who has power of attorney to make all legal decisions about their health and other financial decisions, because the person isn't, you know, compos mentis, as they say, under the law, to make those decisions for themselves. Of course, after her nervous breakdown in the early 2000s, Brittany came out and had said that she's been battling bipolar and depression issues since she was 14. You know, at the time where she initially got sick, gradually, clearly in front of our eyes, a lot of the media just poked fun at her during her initial public decline. And then, you know, through her journey, her parents became the conservator of her estate. And, you know, Brittany was really doing well for a while, but apparently different things going on in the family and health and whatnot has just sent her into a bit of a tailspin. And her manager said that Brittany's in a very fragile space right now, and that his priority is not her career. His priority is Brittany getting better. And, you know, Brittany has been entertaining us for over 25 years, around 25 years, something like that, you know, since she was 14 years old. And she really literally grew up on stage and on TV. And her manager said, you know, she's given enough. And if she never wants to perform again, that's fine, that he only wants her to come back when she's healthy and strong and ready and has the passion to do it. I mean, I also applaud her manager for, you know, looking at her as a human being and not a commodity. That, you know, many managers, as the client gets more and more fiscal and commercial success, lose sight that, you know, their talent might be a product, but, you know, the person is not. And the person's health comes first, and not the potential money that they could make off of you. And, you know, that the management could make off of that person. So Brittany pulled out of her residency in Las Vegas, and is just, you know, taking time to get better. We you know, I really have to apply, because it's hard to come out and say that you have these issues, especially when you're so famous and people don't give you privacy and the space to work out your own stuff. And all of us have to come to those moments where we say, like, hey, you know, the train's moving too fast, gotta slow it down, gotta take care of ourselves, you know, because if we don't take care of ourselves and our own well-being, we can't be a service to anybody. Right, so, you know, there's nothing wrong with saying, look, I gotta stop and I'll come back later, or maybe I won't come back later and I'll just reflect at what I've accomplished. So now, in other noteworthy accomplishments from the world of music, so Missy Misdemeanor Elliott and Justin Timberlake were just honored with honorary doctorate degrees from Berklee College of Music in California. And a couple months back, Vin Diesel got an honorary doctorate as well. And Ciara is gonna step right into Harvard. So she just got accepted to a 4-day business school of entertainment, media, and sports program at Harvard University. So that is super exciting. Now, musician who's talked openly about their battle with depression, Justin Bieber, just announced on his Instagram this week that he is partnering with natural deodorant brand Schmidt's for a new version of the sweat-absorbing deodorant. I actually found out, hey, see, did you know Justin Bieber had a clothing line?
No.
Yeah, I had no idea. I'm like, what? And you know Chris Brown has a clothing line, Pyramid Clothing. A lot of the stuff that he wears, I was researching this, that you see in his music videos,
yes,
right, where it almost kind of looks like race car driving clothes, but with like a little kind of space age twist and then a, say, pyramid on that. That's his clothing line.
Oh, wow, cool.
Yeah. So, and I'll be sure, that throwback, New Jack Swing, New Jack Sexy, R&B singer, I'll be sure, his big song was Night and Day, all right? Well, he just launched his own clothing line as well, called New Jack Sexy. Yes. But, you know, he really hasn't defined what he views New Jack Sexy is. So he has this contest going on right now on his Instagram that if you post a picture of yourself, like you order the clothes, and you post a picture of yourself wearing his New Jack Sexy line and hashtag and, you know, tag him, that he'll share it, and then you'll be entered into a chance to win some free clothing and an all-expense-paid trip to Las Vegas, because that's where he lives now, though he's from upstate New York, and that you'll get to hang out with Al B. Shore. Yeah, right? And hit the clubs and whatnot,
yeah.
All right? So, you know, and just go on to the New Jack Swing nightlife lifestyle. Of course, I'll be sure... wrote along with his own hits, I'll be sure wrote and produced some of Jodeci's big hits, like Forever My Lady. I think it's cool that he's going into the world of clothing. It's more like activewear, like casual stuff. But Justin is coming out with his own deodorant. And it's going to be called Here and Now, and it'll launch this fall. So the company Here and Now has said that the meaning of the company is to be present. It means to be present in daily life. So, of course, in the day of smartphones and social media and all the things we're always trying to fit in, actually being present in what's going on around us is something that we all can rise up to be better at. Not be on that date with that cell phone, not having your head down on your laptop, you know, at the dinner table when you're supposed to be connecting with each other. Justin Bieber also had come out this year pretty openly that he's battled with depression himself and feeling disconnected. And I just think it's great, you know, that more and more celebs are just coming out of the shadows and think, hey, these are things that I struggle with, because no matter,
it gets
really hard, especially, you know, in entertainment when you're grinding in that lifestyle, and it's not a 9-to-5 kind of thing, and it's hard to turn off, and you get it kind of sometimes can lose sense of self as you're grinding from project to project and all these odd hours, you know. So, and you know, speaking of other male celebs that have clothing lines, did you know that Shamar Moore has his own clothing line called A Baby Girl? And so they're basically yeah, he's always posting something, but he is so funny. He's just has such a great, charismatic, funny personality. I
love watching him and see.
Look, well, me and Shamar go way back to when he hosted Soul Train. To when he was in The Brothers with Bill Bellamy and the short guy, not Kevin Hart. Oh, the other one. Oh man, he was in Kings of Comedy. No, I mean he still looks like he did when he was 19. Like, what the tea with that?
You would never know.
You would never know. I mean, I could just see Shamar still getting carded at the club. If we didn't know who Shamar was, they'd be like, sir, may I see your ID? What do you mean you're 47? What? Is that a fake ID? Right? So, yeah, you know, it's nice when we see these men out here creating this empowering clothing. Speaking of which, you know, when we were at Warm Daddy's last week, one of the poets, oh, what's his name? Seven the Poet. He actually has his, and he did this original poem all about female empowerment, which is pretty cool. Well, he has his own clothing line, his own t-shirt line as well, which is all like Black Girl Magic tea. So, of course, I bought a couple for my girls and one for myself. So, you know, we all empower and uplift each other. So, you know, but it's nice when you see men out there who are, you know, creating empowering product for women and also setting that role model to other men to proudly empower other women. So, on that note, we're going to take another empowering musical break. When we come back, I will be talking about more Hollywood headlines. So keep it locked in the Style and Empowerment Chat with Lauren Friends Radio, and we'll be back after this.
What's mine is mine, and what's his is mine.
Okay, girl, you go, girl.
Y'all know it.
Got a new tooth and owe me money, man.
$50, you know what I'm saying. Hey, what are you doing, man?
What are you talking to your girl, man?
That ain't my girl.
That is your girl.
No, they,
that is your
man,
girl.
Man, I know they mine, man.
Put that way before we get locked up again, man.
Man, I just got
man,
out,
I
man.
I was with you.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I know you want lots of jewels and stuff. Backyards with swimming pools, bars with stools and stuff, fancy foods. Sushi, yeah, Versace, Gucci, crazy Lucci. I know your ammo, you do demo on a paycheck. You get a herb from the bourbon, show them no respect. Middle name, price tag, first name, gotcha. Start a slow, got on a roll, now they can't stop ya. Talking about, hey boo, how you do? Some clown uptown said you ran through his crew. I give you props and your credit cause it's due. But I ain't that clown and my crew ain't that crew. Time's too hard to be faking like I'm dating on some staking. Whining and dining, I ain't tricking on no chicken. Leave it up to me, I close the whole store on you. I got nothing but love for you.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got? I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I got nothing but love for you, baby.
Uh-huh.
I got nothing but love for you, honey.
Yeah, whatever.
I'm not your H-E-R-B, but I'm your H-E-A-V. Y-D, don't test me, don't ask me for nothing. For Nathan's, for Jack, for Doodly Squad. You can do me not, you plan on plotting on who be hot and trying to hit the slot. I know you're low pro style, you're low ho profile. Kick a brother in the gut and then you smile. I must admit, I really dig your operation. Every time we on the phone, you got the sexy conversation. So now you hope to be the woman of my dream. And while I'm sleeping, you be creeping, robbing me clean. I see you hanging on the corners with the rest of your girl crew. Standing by the gutter with your booty cutters. So who's the honey dip down with the bunny grip? Always got a plan and a scam to get some money quick. Always getting with the next man, the one with the checks and setting up a trap with the sex. I got nothing but love for you, baby.
What you got?
I got nothing but love for you,
yeah,
honey.
Whatever.
That's that Noxzema girl.
I'm gonna get my groove on.
Got a lot of things I need to explain, but baby, you know the name, and love is about pain. So stop the complaints and drop the order of restraint. Our sex life's a game, so back me down in the paint. I can't wait no more, cause it's about a quarter past three, and sure days I mean, I got the Bentley valet, and I'm just outside of Jersey, past the Palisades, and I love to see that some boots and shades spread out on the bed while I'm yanking your braids. Style. You never thought I'd make you smile while I'm smacking your ass and hitting you all wild. We share something so rare, but who cares? You can, baby.
I'm not always there when you call, but I'm
come on, pull it together. It's only a sun shower. We've been through worse weather. Like a stormy night, you wrote a dear job letter and took my Benz and keyed and cut the leather. Girl, you know better. Be the M.O.B. Money over Brody's murder, I.N.C. I got two or three broads for every V, and I keep them drugged up off that ecstasy. I'm a playground legend like Kirkland Pee-wee. I'm a baller in the league, got more game than me. I play harder, so many women I bothered. Meet them with scars and send them home hot and bothered. Truth to dare, this life ain't apparently fair, and a love with no glare is a crystal stare. But we share something so rare, but who cares? You can, baby.
Mama's boot when the coldest weather. And when I play, you play the same way. You freak me, baby. I f- you crazy. Then I'm gone. And baby, don't really want me to get up and leave off that easy. Should be waking up wet for she's a. Remind these women to mind independence. Believe me, pimp game is very religious. And I'm built like a Don Bishop. Gold deep fish, money green bins. And my bros is my witness. The life we share is a thug affair. But who cares? You care.
just be careful, nah, nah. Love ain't simple, nah, nah. Promise me no promises. Oh, nah, nah. Just be careful, nah, nah. Love ain't simple, nah, nah. Promise me no promises.
I'm gonna be the man who's lonely without you. And when I'm dreaming,
And welcome back to this week's edition of Stone Empowerment Chat with Laura and Friends Radio on Downtown Hot, Take It to the Streets in London Energy Radio. So, speaking of walking 500 miles, I'd like to spotlight, so being a tall drink of water myself, I would like to spotlight some of the other amazing, beautiful, empowered, dynamic, tall divas in the entertainment industries who are not ashamed or apologize for their beautiful tallness. To encourage our other tall, fabulous lady listeners to never make yourself feel like you have to shrink into a corner. Right? So, some of the tallest women in Hollywood include Taylor Swift, who is 5 feet 11 inches tall, Victoria's Secret supermodel and client of my personal makeup artist, Kinsasha Hunter, Karlie Kloss is 6 foot 1. That's not in heels, that's bare feet. Al McPherson, who of course started out as a Sports Illustrated swimsuit model in the 80s, 90s, and was named The Body. Al McPherson is 6 feet tall and just all around badass woman, Venus Williams, is 6'1". I never realized Venus was that tall, but of course she's always running around the court slaying and knocking those tennis balls out the court, so, you know.
That's how I want to play tennis.
Yes, oh my gosh, and that takes so much hand-eye coordination and strength. Hand-eye coordination was never one of my strengths. At all. Even without cocktails. So, Game of Thrones star Gwendolyn Christie is 6'3" tall.
Oh, yeah, she's real tall.
Yeah, she's...
I really made her look like she was, like, kind of thicker, too.
Right.
But she, then, when she took off all
of
them clothes...
Right? You know, all that, that armor put on pounds. Of course, comedic actress Jane Lynch, who was one of the stars of Glee. She played the mother in Talladega Nights. And she also played the boss at the electronics store in the 40-year-old version. The 40-year-old virgin, starring Steve Carell. Jane Lynch is 6'1" tall. Nicole Kidman is 5'11". Now, okay, I just take so much joy in Nicole Kidman's story on this tip, because of course we know that Nicole Kidman was married to Tom Cruise and all his crazy Scientology eccentric couch jumping, you know, ways. And of course, back when they were a couple, Tom Cruise always seemed either the same height or taller than Nicole Kidman, right? Well, after they got divorced, this is what I call classy shade. So after they got divorced, one of the first public statements that Nicole Kidman made was, well, now that we're divorced, I can wear heels again. Because apparently Tom Cruise used to put lifts in his shoes.
Okay. No, why?
So he would look taller, because Tom Cruise is actually only 5'9". But he would tell people he was 5'10", but in actuality, Tom Cruise is only 5'9". Of course, Nicole Kidman is 5'11 and bare feet, which means if she's going on these red carpets, you know, wearing heels, she's 6'2", 6'3".
Yeah.
So apparently Tom's ego couldn't handle that. And of course, Brooke Shields, iconic supermodel of the 70s and 80s, and who later went on to be an accomplished comedic actress. But, of course, Brooke Shields rose to fame as a child and teenage model for Calvin Klein. This is before my time, but, you know, I know of it. So, you know, they had the famous ad campaign, "Nothing Gets Between Me and My Calvins," which at the time was considered very racy, since Brooke was only 14 at the time that ad campaign came out. So, you know, all these groups got all upset because they basically felt that Calvin Klein was sexualizing Brooke Shields and, you know, intimating things about her body intimately at a young age. Well, you know, Brooke Shields is 6 feet tall. And Miss Smize Queen herself, America's Next Top Model, guru, fashion icon, and diva extraordinaire Tyra Banks is 5'11". And I say to all my tall lady listeners that, you know, all of these amazing and dynamic women confidently wear high heels when they hit the red carpet. I myself am 5'10", and, you know, if I want to wear heels, I wear heels. If I want to wear flats, I wear flats. I love my heels. If I'm not coming from work and my feet aren't already having carryover foot pain, right? I mean, I make my decision not based on my height, but how my feet are feeling and what the occasion is, and not what I'm wearing. I mean, you know, not what my height. So, you know, I'm anywhere between 6 feet to 6'2", depending on how high a heel I put on. You know, I see so many amazing, beautiful, tall women out there. And I just want to say, you know, don't let anybody make you feel that you have to try and make yourself appear shorter. Man, check your insecurities at the door, and don't make your lady friend feel like she's less than or weird or awkward because she's tall. The height of her shoe is not gonna change her height. So if you're hung up on all that stuff and you're too insecure to confidently stand next to a tall and beautiful woman who you should be proud to stand next to, the problem isn't with the lady's height. The problem is with your ego and insecurity. And I can tell you from the perspective of a tall woman, if you're pursuing and trying to court a tall woman, the number one pet peeve, which is not going to get you a second date, and quite possibly not even get you a second date. Won't get you a second date, but quite possibly won't get you through the first date. Ladies, see, I have left many a date midway. Right? You never want to ask a tall woman if she has flats. Or if, oh, the next time, could you...
Oh, you wanted to down her height?
Yes. You know, you never want to say to a tall woman, well, next time, could you wear flats? You come out with that malarkey, there's not going to be a next time. In fact, talking from my personal perspective, the clock is ticking on this time. Because you've already annoyed me. Right? Because you're trying to tell me how to be, to make your own self-esteem feel better, which should be coming from within. You shouldn't be telling a woman to basically hunch over, shrink down, appear shorter so you feel better about yourself. Like I said, if I want to wear flats, I'm going to wear flats, but I'm not going to wear it because you're asking me to wear it. Or not wear heels because you don't want to be shorter when you're already shorter to begin with. Okay? Well, my personal experience on the...
I don't like
your guys. Well, you know, the funny thing is, Lady C, I'm naturally drawn to taller guys. Here's the thing I was going to pop into anyway.
Like, yes.
I mean, look, you're tall, your dude being tall on all accounts is best. Okay? A lot of compatibility and things that you can...
No, they just have little attitudes.
Yeah, right. And that's the thing is, right, a lot of the tall men you have more...
They annoy you.
Oh yeah, a lot of the tall men, my experience has been, actually have more hang-ups and insecurities,
yep, they
and they want these short women so they can feel like, oh, Tarzan and all this bullshit. But the shorter guys, hey, they've already adjusted to that eventuality. They know that at least 40% or 30% of most women are going to be taller than them. So they're already, okay, fine, but I like this woman. I'm going to pursue her. They're confident in self because they're not hung up with that because that's been their existence. You know, if you're a dude and you're 5'6", 5'7".
Yeah, 5'6" and all that is cool. Yeah.
All right? You know, no, I mean, for me, I have dated, you know, men that were like in the 5'7" round of range. Yeah. Hey, all right. You know, really, I mean, the thing is, you're attracted to all different things, but sometimes the people that you actually click with, personality-wise and everything, and they're kicking it to you the way you like, and everything, and wind up being shorter. But then, you know, the tall dudes, like, you know, the Enrique Iglesias types, they're all like, oh, I want my woman shorter. Oh, my God, she's in heels. She's the same height as me. Like I said, the short guy's like, well, I know she's going to be taller than me, period, already. So what's an extra couple of inches?
You'll be dating Prince.
Right? Prince was really short.
Yeah, he is a short. No. Cat Williams, no.
Oh, yeah, that's way too short. No. Yeah, I mean.
Kevin Hart, yeah.
Yeah, no.
No, not his height?
Well, just not him, period.
Oh, you just talking about him.
Yeah, but not his height either. He's really short. I mean, some of the celebs I've met are also very short. I mean, you don't mix, you
Your
know.
Camera angles be getting a lot of people.
Oh, yeah.
They
and how they.
I thought you was tall.
Right. Well, you know, if you go to the wax. Right, and even, you know, Carl Anthony Payne was talking about this when in his set and when we met, that a lot of these celebs, men in particular, you know, in person they look much different than TV and the movies. Many of them in person are much smaller. Mm-hmm. Like if you go to...
Oh, he's really short?
Oh, yeah. I didn't realize it until well, look at the pictures. Half of his height is his hat.
But, yeah, I saw it, but
right, and I was in flats actually. Yeah, I didn't. So yeah, he basically came to my shoulder. Yeah, you know. So I mean, there are some men who naturally are that short. Yeah, but at the same point, if the personality is there and they're, you know, they're handsome and, you know, they got a good swag and, you know, approach you right and treat you right, you know, I consider that. But he's out too, like, well, any guy you'd want to date, you got his mindset has to be right.
Yeah.
You know, like, I've literally walked out on dates. When the dude started with the, oh, you're so tall, where are the flats, bullshit. I'm like, I can tell you where these flats are going. Right out the door, bozo. Right out the door.
I'll be walked out
and
be like, the fuck?
Look, okay.
A dude walked out on that game.
Okay, look, a dude comes out with, like, sexist, kind of insecure, controlling nonsense, I'm done.
Yeah, that controlling shit.
No. Okay, so, like, the funniest...
Because that'd be like a woman
okay.
Trying to control stuff.
Exactly. Right. And how about you work on getting to know each other and earning each other's respect and trust before you start trying to boss everybody around? Love isn't a competition.
Yeah.
Well, this was years ago, but I had met this guy at the club. So, you know, we were sitting down. That's another mistake. We're sitting down, and I was like cocktails and in between dancing and whatnot. I'm like, oh, he's cute. So we're just talking and chatting, whatever, flowing. And he asked for my number, so I'm like, all right, I'll give him the real one. So.
She's giving out fake junk.
Yes. Yo. It's story time. Oh, I have another.
You get somebody a fake.
I know. I know.
You real quick.
Right.
Doll it.
Exactly.
You can't do that.
See, that worked before color ID.
Yeah.
So, get two funny stories. Okay. So, all right. So, we're talking on the phone and, like, let's set up the date and whatever. So, you know, he lived in Center City. So I said, okay, well, let's meet at the Lowe's Hotel in the lobby. Because it's near the train station. And then we were going to do some things in the city. I think
right. Go
to lunch and then this and that and the other thing, right? So, you know, he meets me on the one side of Market Street, closest to the train station. And then we're going to cross over and go to the Lowe's, right? And then
right. Go
and do whatever. So, when we meet on the sidewalk, I'm already like, yo, dude's a lot shorter than I remembered. I'm like, oh, snap. But, you know, I'm polite about it.
Right.
I don't go tell him to go out and buy some heels. Okay? And say, yo, shorty, level up. Okay? So, then as we're crossing the street, he says to me, you know, this is where a gentleman filter, just because it's in your head doesn't mean it should come out of your mouth.
Yes.
So, we're crossing the street, and dude says to me, oh, you're a lot taller than I realized or that I remember. And I'm thinking, yeah, and you're a lot shorter than I thought you were. Alright, but that's what was in my mind. But again, I'm trying to be polite. Okay, even though he's immediately getting on my nerves with that. So then as we continue to cross the street, he says to me, oh, do you own any flats? You know, next time, can you wear flats? I'm internally laughing, and I'm thinking, idiot, you think there's going to be a next time?
Yeah.
You've already annoyed me now twice in 5 minutes.
Damn.
I'm like, no way am I spending my afternoon with you. And I feel if you're going to be that disrespectful,
yeah. Then
you don't deserve my respect of exiting in an upfront way. So I'm like, oh, you know what? I gotta use the restroom. Here, just wait here in the lobby. I'm just gonna go use the restroom. Now, you know, I've been coming in and out of the Lowe's for years. Again, because the location, a lot of times when I'm coming from work to the city or whatever and different things I'm juggling, oftentimes I'll change at the Lowe's. And glam up at the Lowe's, okay? I like to say the Lowe's has been one of our unofficial sponsors. So, and then, it's a nice place to stay and dine in, etc. So I know all the entrances of, and exits of the Lowe's, which takes up a couple different blocks. So I remembered that there was an exit at the back side of the Lowe's that let you off down the street and around the corner. So I'm like, oh yeah, I'll go. I go use the restroom. Just wait for me here. I'll be back in a few, and then we'll go grab some lunch. And he's like, oh yeah, okay, cool, whatever. So I went to the lobby, and I messaged my friend. And I'm like, yo, I'm in town, what you up to? And then I left the hotel and I went out and met my girlfriend for lunch. I'm like, I'm done. Like, that nonsense is so ignorant that it doesn't even really, like, deserve your respect. I'm not saying, like, oh, ghost and walk away from situations, but when somebody is basically comfortably being a jerk from the jump, I'm like, exit stage left. No,
okay, so you left him.
Oh, yeah, I left him. And then I blocked him. Because I'm like, there's nothing...
Yo, I bet he probably
wanted to talk
about that.
Hey, I'm like, you sexist, blah, 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 blah. There's absolutely nothing that we really need to talk about again. But thank you. Now, my other funny said, literally, I feel like I could write a little book about this stuff. So, the one and only time, this was a couple years ago, one of my friends, now, I never do hookups, like blind dates from friends, and, oh my God, I have this amazing person, and then this and that, because it's never what you're looking for, ever. So, this close friend of mine, kept saying, oh, I have this nice guy you want to be. I'm like, look, I'm really not looking for anything right now. Come on. And she kept asking. I'm like, fine. Like, I'll meet this dude for sure. What's he like? Oh, he's handsome. And he's a son, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Okay, I don't remember the details specifically. But I do remember is this dude was way old.
Wow.
Bald and not anywhere near my type, and had a very annoying kind of, like, a clingy but boring personality. I get to the lobby, this dude's walking around me, and I'm thinking, oh, I know that dude's not him. And then the next thing you know, I think I was at the bar or whatever, the next thing is, hi, are you Laura? May I join you? I'm looking at this dude. And I'm like, yo, I'm straight out about to pop off on my friend. Like, what the tea? Really? 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 So, and then he's got a couple of kids, and he's divorced, and he's finding himself again, and all this freaking BS. Like, I'm like, really? And we're not, and he's not driven. We're not, like, he's just a dud of a personality. I'm like, wow, that's super exciting. And the bartenders kept looking at, who were cuter than the date, kept looking at me like, kind of like, whoa, why is she with this dude? Okay? And I'm like, okay, how am I going to politely get out of this? And you know when you're in these social situations where within the first 5 minutes, you know the vibe's not right, it's not going to go anywhere,
Yeah. The
personality isn't clicking, and you're like, God, how do I get out of this situation?
That's tough.
Right, you're trying to be polite, and it's not like with the shoe guy where he's actually done anything rude and offensive. But it's just like watching paint peel to being in the person's company, right? We've all had those situations. So I'm thinking, okay, how do I exit this and stuff? So we were maybe about 20 minutes in. We ordered drinks. Oh, and then the other thing, which was like a H to the no. We were meeting around dinner time. Dudes, listen to me carefully. If you set a date at a restaurant with a female between the hours of 5 and 7, that means you're buying her food. It's a dinner date. Mm-hmm. The drinks are pre-dinner drinks, warming up the conversation for you to settle and have a meal together. Oh, what are you gonna? Oh, let's have a martini, then see you on your way. It's 6 o'clock. She's just getting off work. She's hungry. Oh, I'm good. I'm not hungry. Okay, cheapo. Really? And on top of what the dudes are like, oh, I'm not really hungry. And he asked for separate checks. I'm like, wow, you're a winner. Okay, so I go to the bath.
What did you go out for?
Exactly. So I go, and then he's like, oh, my God, you're so beautiful and amazing and this and oh and that. And oh, what's your schedule look like? We weren't even done. The first date, we were already, like I say, only about a half hour in, and he's already like pressuring me for the second date, and oh my God, you're so this. I'm like, you're not entertaining me on the first date, bro. Like, let's work on making this date enjoyable, because so far it's boring. Okay, so. I said, look, I gotta go to the restroom. I'll be right back. Okay, so I
another trick.
Right. So I go to the bathroom and I'm passed by one of the servers and I pull him to the side and I write down my phone number. And I wrote on this date on the piece of paper. I said, I'm on one of the most boring dates of my life. Please help. So, because I didn't want to be overheard.
Yeah.
So, because we're still near the bar. And then I'm going to the bathroom, which was in the next dining room.
Uh-huh.
So he follows, I mentioned to him, like, come here. So I said, look, here's my number. I said, when I come back, about 5 minutes or so later, I need you to dial this phone number. It's my cell phone. Don't be at the bar. Be in another room of the restaurant.
Right.
You don't even have to say anything.
Yeah.
All I need is for the phone to ring, and I got it from there. I'm going to fake an emergency. So the phone rings.
Today.
So the phone rings and I was like, I looped my sister into this. I'm like, it wasn't her, it was the waiter, but I'm like, oh my God, are you okay? Wait.
No.
Yes, because I had to create the scenario that I had to rush off now. So I'm like, where are you at? Did you call AAA? Oh my God, are you in a safe place? Look, I'll be right there. Okay, just give me about 15, 20 minutes and I'll be right there. So I said, oh, I'm sorry. I said, my sister's broken down and AAA's like an hour away and she's, you know, not in the best place. I gotta run. Look, I'll catch you later. And then he's asking for my phone number. I'm like, dude, look, I'll get it to you later. I gotta go. Like, that's my sis. I'll see you later. And I get in my car.
Hidden the pain
in the room. I know. So I get in my car. And I drive down the street to the gas station. I got myself some gas. And the date was at a restaurant that I liked. So I go to the gas station, and I'm just waiting about 20 minutes till I figure he's going to be gone. Uh-huh. And then I circle back, and then I got myself some dinner right. After he left. I'm like, see you later, friend. Then I call my girl. I'm like, yo, what the bleepity bleep beep beep was that? I'm like, how would you think we would be a fit?
Why do people feel like they need to look up any?
I know, exactly.
That's why everybody always asks me to hook them up, but I'm like, no.
There's always beef. No.
Like, somebody always got a problem.
Right?
It's not that they bored, it's just that they start fighting. And then I'm like, yo, I told you not to do it.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, now I didn't even go there. Okay, but when this gal that I knew in high school, we recently ran into each other after 25 years or talking, catching up, exchange phone numbers, texting back and forth, we want to get together for some lunch, cocktails. My schedule, as you know, is always jam-packed and crazy busy. So then all of a sudden, randomly, keeping in mind we haven't had our reunited and it feels so good friend lunch date, whatever, you know, yet between us. So she texts me randomly out of nowhere. I think I had sent her some photo from an event or something, or she asked what I was doing over the weekend. I'd gone out with some friends and whatnot. So she was asking me, oh, did you have a date or dating? I'm like, oh, well, I'm dating. I'm always dating. But, you know, it was just that was my friends that weekend. So then she says, oh, my uncle-in-law saw your picture. Oh, really? How did that coincidentally happen? Right? When you don't live in the same space. And I don't know this dude. How did he coincidentally see my picture? So she says, oh, he saw your picture. And, you know, he thinks you're really pretty. And he wanted to meet you. I'm like, okay, lots of dudes think that. But what's this guy bringing to the table? So right away I'm thinking, wait, uncle-in-law? How old is this dude? Because she's around my age. I'm thinking, how old is your husband and how old is this guy? So I'm like, what the heck? So then I said, okay, well, what are the details? So, okay, he got a good job and stuff on paper and business and from Florida, now living here, blah, 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 whatever. And then she says the specific town that he lives in, which is a very, like, underpopulated, remote suburb. I'm like, okay, well, I'm like city hustle on the go driven career lady. Mm-hmm. And this dude's like, let's go watch Churning Butter. You know, okay, happy to be in the slow, slow rural suburb. That's not going to be a fit off the bat. So what are you thinking there? So, of course, she leads into the, well, he's very handsome for his age. I'm thinking, oh, okay.
For her, not for you.
Right, and I'm thinking, let's put it this way. If your husband left you, Would this dude be next? Would you be hot for his wagon? If the answer is no, chances are neither would I. You know, if you don't want to hitch your own wagon to this dude, if it was an option, what is making you think I would? So I said, picture. So she says, oh, I have to look up and see if I find one. Okay, again, that's not a good sign.
It won't be like Chris Tucker on Friday.
Why? I'm like, yo, if you're trying to connect people, the first thing you do is send the picture.
Yeah.
To see if they're each other's types. So, finally, I get a picture. I was so angry. I'm like, girl, Now, this is so off track that our lunch isn't even going to happen.
Yeah.
Between us as friends. Mm-hmm. No disrespect or anything, but this guy wasn't remotely my physical type. At all. At all. And he was much older. No disrespect. But I'm like, he was only 8 years younger than my father.
Ooh.
I'm like, what? And I'm thinking, he's your uncle-in-law. Okay, well, I find out her husband is about 10 or 12 years younger than her.
So
hook me up with Grandpa. Well, you're there with the cute model. Okay. Give me the third-hand car. Oh, why, thank you. Okay, and I know right off the bat this dude wouldn't be able to keep up with my grind. I'm like, what? Did you hit your head? And then I said, look, he's not my type, but maybe we can be friends. I mean, I know I have nothing in common with this person. I'm trying to be polite. I'm figuring she's going to get to him. No, instead she turns around and says, oh, well, can I give him your number so you guys can start becoming friends?
No.
No, you cannot. And that's boundary crossing. How about you just give me his number and I'll call him at a quarter to never. Okay, like, hello, don't you want to match people together that actually have things in common? So I didn't even waste my time with the okay. I'm just like, no, Narcissus, thanks. And of course I never gave her, I said give my, but again, that's a violent, you know, come on, read people's cues. You know, don't cross boundaries. The person's already saying no to you. Like, I've seen some of my friends with each other, like, so intensely trying to hook each other up. Oh, come on, come on. Oh, he'd be great for her. Why don't you go for that guy? Why are you so worried about your friend's love life?
Yeah.
And monkeying in it.
Yeah. If I was them, I wouldn't want nothing to do with it. Like,
exactly.
Everybody do what they do.
Right.
You bring them a good selection and they choose to be like, oh, well, I'm going to go hang out with this friend, you know, he's real cool. That's something different. But
exactly.
Bring everybody together in the room and see if
and let each other find you. That's the best way. If you're hoping maybe two of your mutual friends will hit it off, just put them in the same room together and see if they naturally find themselves. Mm-hmm. Together.
That's the right way to do it.
Right. And then nobody's accountable for anything. Because, of course, if you try and fix somebody up with someone who's way, way, way off base of their type, your friend's going to get mad.
Yeah.
And then that's going to change the...
Yeah, and then your friends going to be talking about each other. And I'm
exactly. And then you're trying, right. And then
I got to leave my other friend alone because you don't want me to be around that friend because you slept with them.
Right. Okay. Or he was trying to hit on
that's
you and this and that.
This is crazy.
Right? So, you know, the moral of this story is I don't try and set people up. And I'm not about to set up. You know what you like and you know what you want. So, you know, let people go find their own people, I say. just picking up on our tall Hollywood ladies. So Lisa Kudrow, of course, is 6 feet tall. She recently just came out publicly. And, of course, Lisa was one of the stars of the mega influential sitcom Friends, which starred Matthew Perry. What was the other guy's name? something Chevet or something like that, Courtney Cox, Jennifer Aniston, and of course Lisa Kudrow. And so Lisa opened up that at the height of her fame, she would compare herself to Jennifer Aniston and Courtney Cox and would all often feel that she was too tall, too big boned, and just in general, too heavy compared to them. And she said that the network actually put a lot of pressure because, of course, Courtney Cox and Jennifer Aniston, they're petite.
Yeah.
You know, they're naturally thinner women, and Lisa Kudrow is 5'11", and naturally just has a denser body frame. So she felt so much pressure to lose weight and be thin like Courtney Cox and Jennifer Aniston that she severely dieted down. And then she wound up having all these health issues.
Wow.
She said, she got colds all the time and bacteria infections and all kinds of different and fatigue issues. Yeah, because her antibodies were so low from really being underweight for her size. And the thing that made it more complicated was then she was getting praise for looking good. But she was actually very much underweight for her size. And she, you know, went on to say that over time, after the show ended, that she became much more comfortable, you know, with her sense of self. And her, not only her weight, but her age and just embracing the aging process. And of course, but Hollywood puts so much pressure on women to look a certain way, and there's this twisted thinking, especially in the music industry, oh, unless you have a Sierra type body, oh, you're not going to make it. Right? But of course, there are R&B soul singers of all different shapes who are successful. But in the world of TV, the studio had put a lot of pressure on both men and women to be, small, small, small. And then oftentimes they wind up, men and women, developing eating disorders. Randy Quaid. Is Randy the older brother? Dennis Quaid. Dennis Quaid, who was, the short blonde, leaving Seattle. Meg Ryan. Is Meg Ryan's ex-husband. And he came out publicly that he had developed anorexia for many years and would vomit and purge because he was trying to look the eye candy leading man, and he had nerves and pressure, and Hollywood and the entertainment industry in general, music industry, fashion, puts pressure on men and women to be some predetermined, quote, perfect version of themselves, which oftentimes is unhealthy, unhealthy weight on the smaller side. And, really, it just gets down to another form of size shaming. That, if you're too tall, you should apologize for yourself and try to be something else. If you're too short, you should feel bad about yourself and try and be something else so other people feel more comfortable or less insecure or this or that, or you got to be a certain weight, a certain this, a certain that. And why do we have to really get in people's sauce so much? We can't enjoy somebody's talent and their comedic timing and laugh if they're a size 8 versus a size 00. Does that make them any less funny?
No.
You right? Our dress size or our suit size you know, doesn't determine our worth and our talent. And our body's always changing, you know? And, I mean, then you have people in the public eye who are already fine and doing all this crazy plastic surgery, like Cardi B.
Oh, I'm not doing that today.
All right, you know, she's fine. She already has her fake ass. And then she just got boob job and liposuction and didn't wait and heal properly. And now she had to cancel her whole tour.
And
yeah, it was just announced yesterday.
Because
she has all these infections and stuff from being active too soon after her recent plastic surgery. Which she didn't need to begin with. Which, of course, is sending the message to all these young girls that, first of all, to be beautiful, you need to have plastic surgery. Second of all, if you do it, not to be responsible and really take care of yourself and heal properly. Well, you heard it first on Style and Empowerment. Breaking news! Hey, so some breaking news that I can't fully release yet, but acclaimed Philadelphia event planner Noel Zayas is actually planning something very big and special in Philadelphia to celebrate Gay Pride Month. This is something, it has to do with fashion, I'll say. Our city has never seen anything like this before. It's really, really massive what's going to be happening. And I got the inside scoop. And I'll be bringing the developments as they happen. And I get authorized to say something. But it's like I'm probably going to be involved in this in some capacity. So I'll keep you posted with exciting details, but they can't wait too long because Pride is right around the corner. Tuesday. June 1st. Oh, that's June 1st is Saturday, right? Next Saturday. So we have a couple of days yet. But so, of course, next week we'll be enjoying an encore episode of Style and Empowerment Chat with Lauren Friends, and we'll be out of studio to enjoy the Memorial Day holiday. It's supposed to be a beautiful week here in the 80s. So when we come back June 5th, we will be welcoming to the show singer Thea Austin, who, of course, was the female lead singer of house music, R&B, dance group Snap from the 90s. Of course, their big hits were I Got the Power and Rhythm is a Dancer. They're literally on the same level as CNC Music Factory and CeCe Peniston. So we're excited to welcome Thea to the show next week. So we're going to take you out with our last musical break. So until next time, stay strong, stay beautiful. Follow me on Instagram at SRPKLDiva, and like and follow the Style and Empowerment Chat with Lauren Friends Facebook page. Have a wonderful holiday if you're here in the States, and we will be back next week in June, and we'll see you next time.
The truth, the money never lie. No, I'm the one, yeah. I'm the one early morning in the dark. No, you wanna ride now. I'm the one, yeah. I'm the one, yeah. Hear you sick of all those other imitators. Don't let the only real one intimidate ya. See you watching, don't run out of time now.
make your dreams come true when you wake up. And your looks just the same without no makeup. Had to pull up on your mama, see what you made of. Ain't got a word about them commas, cause my cake up. You can ride inside my life on that fame bus. Cause I promise when we step out, you'll be famous. Modern day Bunny and Clyde, what they named us. Cause when we pull up, all angles.
Yeah, you're looking at the truth, the money never lie, no. I'm the one, yeah, I'm the one. Early morning in the dark, know you wanna ride now. I'm the one, yeah, I'm the one, yeah. Hear you sick of all those other imitators. Don't let the only real one intimidate ya. See you watching, don't run out of time now.
That new Chanel. She liked the price. She see the ice and make her coochie melt. When I met her in the club, I asked her who she felt. Then she went and put that booty on that Gucci belt. We don't got no label. She say she want bottles. She ain't got no table. She don't got no bed frame. She don't got no tables. We just watching Netflix. She ain't got no cable. Okay, though. Plug, plug, plug. I'm the plug for her. She want a nigga that pull her hair and hold the door for her. That's only me. Miss it, okay with me. Baby, okay, okay, okay.
Yeah, you're looking at the truth. The money never lie. No, I'm the one, yeah. I'm the one. Early morning in the dawn. Know you wanna ride now. I'm the one, yeah. I'm the one, yeah. Hear you sick of all those other imitators. Don't let the only real one intimidate ya. See you watching, don't run out of time now. I'm the one, yeah.
Looking for the one, what bitch you looking at the one? I'm the best yet, and yet my best is yet to come. Cause I've been looking for somebody, not just any fucking body. Don't make me catch a body, that's for any and everybody. Oh my God, she hit me up all day, get no response. Bitch, you blow my heart, that's like turning gold to bronze. Roll my eyes, and when she on the molly, she a zombie. She think we Clyde and Bonnie, but it's more like Whitney Bobby, God forgive me. Don't you ever finesse, and I'm a legend. Straight up out the crescent, fly your bay down for the essence. For the record,
truth, the money never lie, no. I'm the one, yeah. I'm the one. Early morning in the dawn, know you wanna ride now. I'm the one, yeah. I'm the one, yeah. Hear you sick of all those other imitators. Don't let the only real one intimidate ya. See you watching, don't run out of time now. I'm the one, yeah. Don't you know, girl? Don't you know, girl? I am the one for you.
I'm the one.
Yeah, I'm the one. Don't you know, girl? Don't you know, girl? I am the one for you.
I'm the one.
Yeah, I'm the one. Don't you know, girl? Don't you know, girl? I am the one for you.
I'm the one.
Yeah, I'm the one. Don't you know, girl? Don't you know?